तक्षर अमृतमेना तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप गदामयं ददाति सपरांशिकम् आदानस्तुणं दंतरिदं याचे पुनः पुनः श्रीमद्रूपदाम्बुजविश्यां जन्म जन्मनि अनर्पितचरिञ्चिरात् कर्णावतीर्णाकलौ समर्पयितुमुन्नतो जलरसां स्वभक्ति श्रियं हरट हरिपुरट सुंदरद्युति कदंब संदीपिता कदा हृदय कंदरे स्मृतवा शचिनंदन सर्वथम स्मरे गुरुपाद पद्मनिला पृष्ठ जगत गुरु श्रीमत भक्तिदांत नारायण गोस्वामी महाराज जी के अभय चरणार विंदो में अनंत कोटि दंडक प्रणाम अर्पण करता हूँ। अंतर उपस्थित रंडी पाद सन्यासी श्री श्रीमद भक्तिदांत दंडी महाराज नामनिष्ठ संत श्री अनिरुद्ध दास प्रभु जी और समस्त वैष्णव वैष्णव के चरणों में मेरा यथाज्ञ दंडवत प्रणाम मैं अर्पण करता हूँ और उनकी कृपा की प्रार्थना करता हूँ। तो सो टुडे वी आर डिस्कसिंग माधुर्य कादंबिनी। आई थिंक वी आर ऑन द टेक्स्ट 4 पेज नंबर 54 आई एम नॉट रॉन्ग। भगवान्स मर्सी पोटेंसी इज इंटरेस्टेड टू द डिवोटी। सो हियर श्रील गुरुदेव इज टेलिंग दैट Bhagwan has mercy potency and that is entrusted to his devotee. It means that the devotee can bestow the mercy on other living entities. So an objection may be raised that it is not possible for the mercy of the devotee to exist first before the mercy of Bhagwan, because the actions of the devotees are inspired by Bhagwan. But this cannot be, because Shri Bhagwan, who accepts a mood of submission to his bhaktas, personally offers his mercy potency to them so that they can elevate those who are desirous of performing Hari Bhajan. So it means that Bhagwan is very kind to the devotees, like he told Ambarish Maharaj, Aham bhakta paradino nahi asadantra iva dvija sadhuvir grastar deyam bhakto bhakta janapriya. He told Durvasa that I am controlled by my devotees. Just like how the chaste woman controls her husband, my devotees control me. Because they have offered everything, all their possessions, wife, children, bank balance to me. So I am controlled by my devotees. So Bhagwan, he accepts the mood of submission to his bhaktas. And he personally offers his mercy potency to them, so that they can elevate those who are desirous of performing Hari Bhajan. So devotees now have the mercy potency of Bhagwan with them. So if they want, they can also very easily bestow mercy on others. They are empowered to do so. That is called power of attorney. Or we get to a notary, then he gives us the power of attorney. So like that, the devotees have power of attorney of Bhagwan. If they want, they can bestow bhakti on anyone. They can show mercy to anyone. And especially if anyone will approach a devotee, I want to do bhajan. Then devotee immediately will say, yes, you can. And immediately that person will start to do bhajan. This happens because Bhagwan has empowered the devotee. So Bhagwan, the indwelling super soul, has governance over the living entities. So you can see that we are all controlled by Paramatma. Dvamimo purusho lake sharas shaksharai vacha sharas sarvani bhutani utostakshara ucchate. In Bhagavad Gita it is told that there are two types of living entities, the fallible and infallible. So Paramatma is infallible, the living entities are fallible. So super soul who is infallible can control the living entities who are fallible. So he maintains control of only those living entities who through their external senses are reaping the fruits, their previously unseen destiny of lifetimes of sinful and pious activities. In regard to his own devotees, however, Bhagwan's personal direct grace is seen. So there are living entities in this world who are suffering the reaction to their past action. Anything that happens to us, we should know for sure that is happening by the desire of Bhagavan. So we should not retaliate. We should not try to take revenge on someone, because we are responsible for what is happening to us. Like Gurudev said, that someone is slapping us, what we should do? Someone is abusing us, cursing us, using cuss words, what we should do? He said, you should not curse that person back. Never and never you should do that. You should know that that person is cursing me because I cursed him in the past life. So I don't want to set again the ball in motion, the karma cycle again in action. That great wheel of karma again, I don't want to start it evolving. So I should tolerate. If someone is acting badly to me, should tolerate. For example, Ambarish Maharaj example we can see. Durvasa plucked out his dreadlocks and he created a fire demoness to devour Ambarish. But did Ambarish ran to Bhagavan, please save me like this? Nothing. He simply said to Bhagavan, thy will be done, as you like. He folded his hands and remembered lotus feet of Bhagavan. He didn't worry, he didn't even say to Bhagavan, please protect me. But Bhagavan has designated his Sudarshan Chakra to protect the devotees. So Sudarshan Chakra started chasing Durvasa. Durvasa could not find any respite. Although he went to Kailash, he went to Brahmaloka, even Vaikuntha planet, he could not find any relief. Finally, by the order of Sri Narayan, he came to the earth, gliding to the earth again, fell down at the feet of Ambarish Maharaj. And Ambarish Maharaj prayed to the Sudarshan Chakra and then he had some relief. For one entire year, Ambarish Maharaj had not taken any food. Somehow or other, he was following Ekadashi. When Durvasa came, he offered pranam to Durvasa, gave him prasad, and then ate his remnants of Durvasa. He never thought that Durvasa has harassed me, he wanted to kill me. Never he kept. So devotees don't keep anything that is done to them in their mind. But they are always willing to help even their worst enemies. Like Bharat Maharaj. And also Bharat Maharaj was fighting against so many kings before when he was a king. But once he renounced everything and became a sadhu, oh, he used to beg from his own enemies. In this way, he showed great humility. And actually, Srila Param Gurudev also told that if you want to be humble, you have to beg. For brahmachari, sannyasis, vanaprastha devotees, the only way of maintenance is begging. They have no other business, no other bank balance. They don't have any factories. One time, Srila Sanatan Prabhu, Srila Bhakti Vedanta Muni Maharaj, later on, he took sannyas with Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj of ISKCON. So he told Param Gurudev that, please, why the brahmacharis are going door to door begging? I find it, not so good. So I want to use my expertise in business. I was a successful business when I was a grihastha. I would suggest that we'll manufacture, I know some formulae, chemical formulae, we can manufacture some good quality soaps. We sell these soaps and will be easily maintained. No need that our brahmacharis have to go door to door and tolerate the abuse and sometimes, derogatory words spoken against them. So Param Gurudev said, no. I don't want my brahmacharis to be ease loving. They should not be pampered and they should not be accustomed to enjoying material comforts. I want that my brahmacharis get abused. They are talking ill words. They are chastised, criticized, vilified when they go door to door. That will keep their faults again control. They will realize they are servant dependent on mercy of Guru and Krishna and Vaishnavas. Then only they will be humble. Otherwise, they will never be humble. So, the only and only means of survival for the brahmachari, sannyasis and vanaprasthas is that they should beg door to door. They should only depend on the donations from the people, from householders, which are earned with great humility. Because if you are going to get any donation from anyone, you have to just fold your hands, bow down your head. Please give something for service of Thakurji. And it creates great humility in the heart. And that is very, very important. So you see that Param Gurudev rejected the proposal of Srila Sanatan Prabhu, Bhaktivedanta Munima. So here, Bhagwan, so devotees, they have no sinful activities or pious activities. We want to burn both sinful activities and pious activities. We don't want to engage, we don't want to enjoy the results of pious activities, nor we want to suffer from the sinful reactions of past. We want to burn both of them. Understand? So devotees who are completely unattached to sin and pious merit, they are under the direct personal grace of Bhagwan. They are under the mercy of Bhagwan. But karmis, they are simply suffering from the results of their past actions. And there is no intervention on the part of Bhagwan in their suffering. Bhagwan doesn't really care whether they suffer or enjoy. But for devotees, he really worries about them. So here in this construct, Srimad Bhagavad Gita says, Tat prasadat param shantim sthanam prapsasi. By the gracious blessing of that supreme controller Ishvara, you will achieve ultimate peace and the eternal abode. So Bhagavad Gita again and again gives this important instruction to us. Tat prasadam param shanti. We all want shanti. Anyone who is now watching the war between Ukraine and Russia, who wants that war to go on? Both sides are losing men, manpower, wealth, buildings, children are suffering, many children are dying. So no one wants this type of war. But they don't know how to obtain peace. Once they asked one question to Srila Gurudev, Oh Gurudev, there are so many hungry children in your India. Why don't you create some mission by which we can give food to the hungry children? We can feed them so that there will be no hunger. Gurudev said, very good idea. You are suggesting me that I should feed the hungry children. But he said, what about America, Canada, Russia, England, Holland? These are rich countries, first world countries. There plenty of food is there. No one should go hungry there. They have excess grain production. But although there is no problem of hunger there, still there are so many suicides. There are so many suicides there. So much crime is there. Why? Why so many suicides and crime there? Gurudev asked this question. So Gurudev said that this is due to the lack of compassion for the living entities. They have no compassion for the animals like goats, ducks, turkeys, chicken, cows, buffaloes, no mercy, horses. Gurudev said that they eat anything that flies in the sky except for the airplane. Just because they don't know how to eat an airplane, they don't kill an airplane. And they eat anything that has four legs except for the bed, cot. You know, anything that has four legs, they'll eat. They think that, Gurudev was telling that everything is for their tongue, for their enjoyment. They can kill anyone and eat. So that is what is causing the problem of lack of peace. How can there be peace if we are hurting other living entities? We should never hurt other living entities. So here the word prasad must certainly be understood as grace in the form of him being bestowing his personal mercy potency. So Bhagavan is bestowing his mercy potency on the devotees. Prasad means mercy, grace. So again, Piyush Roshan Vritti, someone may say that since bhaktas are subordinate to the will of Bhagavan, how can their mercy awaken independently without Bhagwan's will or inspiration? say that bhaktas are subordinate to the will of Bhagavan. Like they say, thy will be done. Oh Lord, you are in control. I am not in control. Like Prahlad never prayed to Bhagavan, please mitigate my suffering. Hanuman never prayed to Ram, please mitigate my suffering. Pure devotees never pray to Bhagavan to mitigate their suffering. They depend only on the will of Bhagavan. So, question is how their mercy is independent of Bhagavan's will or inspiration. Their answer is since inspiration from Bhagavan also underlies the bhakta's mercy. That inspiration is to be considered the prime cause of good fortune. And it takes the form of the mercy of these great souls. So it means that mercy of the devotee is coming from the inspiration from Bhagavan. Bhagavan inspires him in the heart. And then that person will start. Once the devotee bestows mercy as inspired by Bhagavan, then that person who receives the mercy starts to engage in devotional service. Like Gurudev was giving initiation, and one male devotee, he told Gurudev that, I don't want to change my previous name. Maybe some other guru had given him that name. Then Gurudev said, how can you put a condition like that? I don't want to change my name. The present name which some guru has given you is a demon's name, not a devotee name. So you must undergo that change. And if you want to put that condition, then don't be initiated by me. Because diksha means you should completely surrender to Guru. Whatever name he will give me, I should accept that name. Whatever ashram he will keep us in, we should accept that ashram. Like Gurudev was making a point that there are some brahmacharis, he said, they are telling that we don't want to leave Mathura Math. Like when Gurudev was there, living in Keshoji Gaudiya Math, apparently Gurudev created another ashram, Durvasa Ashram, across the Jamuna, which was in the small village. Understand? It was in a small village. So no one wanted to go to that Durvasa Ashram. Even today, that ashram is not very populated, means not many brahmacharis stay there, apparently. But Mathura Math is always jam-packed. So Gurudev said, what is this? If I tell them to go to Durvasa Ashram or some Giridhari Gaudiya Math, they don't want to go. They want to stay in Vrindavan or Mathura, where all the objects of sense gratification are available. See, Gurudev said, this is not bhakti. And if Gurudev would tell someone, go to Durvasa Ashram, that brahmachari would reply, oh, Gurudev, I think I should go on entire pilgrimage of India. And I will come in the Kartik time when all the devotees from India and the Western countries will come. I will do the parikrama. Again, I will go for the India too. But I don't want to stay in Durvasa Ashram or Giridhari Gaudiya. So Gurudev said, this is not bhakti. Gurudev gave the example of Nishikant Sanyal, Professor Nishikant Sanyal. He was a disciple of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada. Once they all went to board a train with Prabhupada. I think they were going to Kolkata, I mean Howrah, from I think Krishnanagar or someplace. Don't remember, but so everyone wanted to be on the same train with Prabhupada. So as soon as train arrived, they all boarded the train. After Prabhupada. Prabhupada boarded the train, they also boarded the train. But Nishikant Sanyal was standing peacefully on this platform. He didn't board the train. Someone pointed to Prabhupada. Prabhupada, see, Nishikant Sanyal is not boarding the train. Then Prabhupada said, Nishikant, why you are not boarding the train? He said, Prabhupada, you never told me to board the train. How can I board a train? I don't want to be a burden on you. I just don't want to tag along without your permission. If there is your will, I will come. It is beneficial for your service, I will come. Otherwise, I will not come. So this is, so Gurudev was telling that although in Raganuga Bhakti, but this may not carry much importance in Raganuga Bhakti, but Gurudev said that this is highlighting one very important point, that we should always try to please Gurudev, we should never challenge his order, and we should always be submissive to his orders, however unpleasant his order may be at the outset. But we should be saying, yes, आई विल डू दैट. चलो भक्ति रक्षक श्रीधर महाराज गिव्स एन एग्जांपल ऑफ स्लेव्स. ही सेड व्हाट इज अ स्लेव. अ स्लेव इज लाइक अ सोल्जर. ही इज टोल्ड गो वॉक 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 सो मार्च. ही गॉट द ऑर्डर फ्रॉम द कमांडर. द सोल्जर विल मार्च लेफ्ट राइट लेफ्ट राइट लेफ्ट राइट लेफ्ट राइट. और इन हिंदी से बाय देना देना बाय देना बाय देना बाय लेफ्ट राइट. और दो जो हरे कृष्णा सोल्जर जो से हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे. इधर वे व्हेन द मार्चिंग ऑर्डर्स आर देयर द सोल्जर कैनॉट स्टॉप. एंड इफ द सोल्जर स्टॉप्स देयर इज नॉट फॉलोइंग द ऑर्डर. इफ अ वैली कम्स स्टिल द सोल्जर कैनॉट स्टॉप. ही हैज टू कीप ऑन मार्चिंग एंड जंप इन द वैली. दैट इज द मिलिट्री डिसिप्लिन एंड दैट इज वॉट इज ऑल अबाउट स्लेवरी. So we are the slaves of Guru. Once we have taken initiation, then we have no material possessions. All our material possessions, all our wealth, property, bank balance, children, wife, everything now belongs to Gurudev. And we should utilize everything of that in the service of Guru. That is called real surrender. Understand? So you see that here, so here it is told that it takes the form of mercy of these great souls. And then is bhakti's self-manifesting nature to be accepted. So bhakti is self-manifesting or not? This is a question. So in answer to this question, Srila Vishwanatha Thakur explains that due to Bhagavan's quality of bhakta vatsalya, submission to his devotees, he has voluntarily placed the potency of mercy in the hearts of his bhaktas, such that the bhakta's mercy does not have to wait for Bhagavan's will or inspiration. So here one important point is that Bhagavan has a very great quality called bhakta vatsalya. Bhagavan is not karmi vatsal, he is not yogi vatsal, he is not mayavadi vatsal, he is not gyani vatsal, he is only bhakta vatsal. He doesn't see the devotee's qualities. External qualities of devotee, he doesn't see that. He only sees that devotee is dedicated to me. That's it. Bhagavan immediately becomes so merciful to that devotee that he tells that take this potency of mercy and bestow this mercy on anyone you like. I order you. You will have my complete blessing, my devotee. If you want to give bhakti to someone, you can give it. The moment you want, you can bestow that bhakti upon anyone. I am granting you the full authority to bestow bhakti on anyone and everyone. This is the quality of Bhagavan. Bhagavan gives this power of attorney to his devotees to distribute bhakti. So bhaktas can independently bestow mercy upon ordinary people. So devotees independently, they don't have to call Bhagavan, make a phone call, send email, write a message, SMS him, oh Bhagavan, shall I give bhakti to this person or not? No. No pre-permission is needed. You have 100% full authority to bestow bhakti on anyone and everyone. That is Bhagavan's mercy. Independently, they can bestow mercy on anyone, on their own accord. So this is the great quality Bhagavan has bestowed on devotees. The devotees are the free distributors of mercy of Bhagavan. Without permission of Bhagavan, they can easily give mercy to anyone. So Bhakti Sandarbha Anuchhed 180 says that the particular significance of Mahat Krupa, the mercy of his devotee, is that if it were not independent, it would have been impossible for anyone in this world to have obtained the mercy of Bhagavan. Mahat Krupa. Actually, about Mahat Krupa, there are many, many verses in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Mahat Krupa vina kono karya bhakti nahi. कृष्ण भक्ति दूर रहो संसार न हो क्षय। महातेरा कृपा बिना कोनो कर्म भक्ति नहीं। इफ एनीथिंग यू आर डूइंग बट दैट एक्टिविटी इज नॉट प्लीजिंग अ प्योर डिवोटी योर स्पिरिचुअल मास्टर देन दैट एक्टिविटी कैनॉट बी टर्म्ड एज भक्ति। सच एन एक्टिविटी कैनॉट इवन बिस्टो लिबरेशन फ्रॉम द साइकिल ऑफ बर्थ एंड डेथ, व्हाट टू स्पीक ऑफ डिवोशनल सर्विस। But know that when I say the words of Guru, the Guru should also be qualified. But if your Guru is telling that you should take one stick and beat up a pure devotee, or you can take a pistol and shoot a pure devotee, will you follow that? If a Guru is telling, giving these orders that hurt that devotee, attack that devotee, beat up that devotee, pure devotee, then you should reject such a Guru. He's not really a Guru in first place. Srila Gurudev said that there was actually one very big problem came, Ritvik system. They were fallen devotees who could not control their senses. But they wanted to control other devotees. So they started introducing this system. They said that we are representatives of Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, and we can give his mercy to you. We are the authorized agents, Ritviks, on his behalf. We'll give a name or mantras on behalf of Prabhupada. But you'll be the disciple of Prabhupada, Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. So the devotees, they are so independent. They can bestow mercy upon others. Understand? But don't accept this Ritvik philosophy. The Gurudev said that this Ritvik philosophy is the bogus philosophy. Understand? And we should try to avoid the association of Ritviks, because it is an unfavorable association. The aim and object of this class is not to criticize any Vaishnavas or any particular organization. But some misconceptions should be cleared. Gurudev always warned us that never go to the Sahajiyas, those who are pretending devotees, imitationists. Understand? Like those who say that we will give you Siddha Pranali, you are this manjari, that manjari. And then finally, that person is nowhere. So always try to maintain faith in Guru. Always try to maintain faith in Guru, his words. Guru is not an ordinary person. Very important to have very good association. Like Gurudev was giving an example of Mohan Prabhu. I am also on Zoom, Prabhu. Hare Krishna. I am also on Zoom. If you like to hear on Zoom, I am there also. So, Hare Krishna. So you can see that Bhagwan is exclusively. So Gurudev was giving an example of a parrot. That parrot, he was living in the house of a thief, a rogue person. Then he used to say sala. Sala means like brother-in-law. Sala. He learned to abuse. But if a parrot was brought up in the company of a sadhu, then what will happen? Then you would learn. Chitrakoot ke ghat me parisantan ki bheer Tulsidas chandan ghise tilak deta raghuveer. Means Tulsidas is making the sandalwood paste, and Ram and Lakshman, they are getting their tilak from Tulsidas' lotus hands. So like this he will sing some slokas. So Gurudev was telling that it is the most important to have very good association. Association is very, very important. Not association of Mayavadis. So Srila Gurudev is telling that the worst thing you can do to yourself is associate with Mayavadis. Srila Gurudev was telling that there are different types of Mayavadis. What are the different types of Mayavadis? There are Mayavadis of Vrindavan. The Mayavadis of Vrindavan accept Srimad Bhagavatam. But the Mayavadis of Kashi, they do not accept Srimad Bhagavatam. Mayavadis of Haridwar accept Srimad Bhagavatam. They accept the transcendental pastimes of Bhagavan. But still they give their wrong interpretations. But the Mayavadis of Kashi absolutely do not accept Srimad Bhagavatam or Bhagavan's transcendental pastime. So deliverance of the Mayavadis of Kashi, impersonalist residing in Kashi, is very difficult. But Mahaprabhu delivered Sri Prakashananda Saraswati by his causeless mercy on the insistence of a Maharashtrian Brahman. Mahaprabhu had some students, they also became against Mahaprabhu, because Mahaprabhu was, instead of teaching them Sanskrit, was teaching them how to chant Hare Krishna and was giving interpretation of every aphorism or sutra of Vyakaran as Krishna based in interpretation. He was relating everything to Krishna, and that is true. Everything is related to Krishna. Everything is related to Narayan. What is the use of all the education if ultimately it doesn't lead to Krishna consciousness? Understand? All the great mathematicians, with all the brains they have, if they don't engage in chanting Hare Krishna mantra, it's all useless. Gurudev was telling that all this wealth, children, family, all will be taken away from you at the time of death. Gurudev was telling that I went to Canada, and in Canada I met one Punjabi person, maybe Sikh, and he came for my class and he was bitterly weeping. So that time I asked him, why you are weeping? He said that I came from India to make money. I have a lot of money now. But the problem is that my daughter doesn't want to listen to me. The other day she brought her boyfriend and she was almost naked. And she was doing everything possible for sense gratification right in front of my eyes. Both were drunk. And when I chastised her, she immediately pulled out a gun and she said, I will kill myself. This is my house. You cannot kick me out of my house. I will do what I like in my house. So that Punjabi man told Gurudev that, did I come to America, Canada, to see this day that my own daughter will not follow me, rebel against me, and do all these nasty things, which will not only embarrass myself, but my mother and father who are also staying with me. That their granddaughter is so spoilt. So he was crying like anything, like a baby before Gurudev. So Gurudev said that America, Europe, Canada has so much money. It's all useless unless there is culture. Unless there is dedication, love between husband and wife, and the children are obeying their parents. So Gurudev told that if householders do not take care of their parents, then when they die, even if they go to heaven, they will not be given any food there. They will have to eat their own flesh. In Ramayana, this story comes. One king used to come from the heaven in an airplane and used to eat the flesh of his own dead body. So, if a person doesn't take care of his old mother and father, then that person will not be happy in any life. But situation is different for brahmacharis and sannyasis, because they dedicate everything to Krishna and they are serving 24 hours a day Radha Krishna. For them, even if they do not take care of their mother, father, Krishna will take care of them. Krishna will arrange that their mother and father will have very good destination after death. But for householders, those who have not renounced everything, they must take care of their mother and father. So here it is told in Bhakti Sandarbha, the particular significance of Mahat Krupa, the mercy of devotees, is that if it were not independent, it would have been impossible for anyone in this world to have obtained the mercy of Bhagwan. Understood? So Bhagwan's devotee's mercy is independent, and that's why anyone can have it. I remember when Srila Gurudev went to America, and then he bestowed Harinam on new people also, who did not have much sanskaras. They were eating sometimes cow's flesh before. But because they met Gurudev, they learned that eating flesh is not good. They became vegetarian, they started chanting Hare Krishna. And then they became first class devotees. They gave up eating meat, fish, eggs, and started chanting Hare Krishna mantra. This is the power of a pure devotee, Mahat Sangha. Because Bhagwan has given the license to the pure devotee. Yasya prasadat bhagavat prasado, yasya prasadan nagati kutopi. Dhyayam stuvam stasya shastri sandhyam vande guru shri charanarvinda. Only by the mercy of pure devotee, we can have mercy of Bhagwan. So, just as there is no possibility of the slightest darkness remaining within the sun, which is the reservoir of profuse light, so it is absolutely impossible for unhappiness to touch Bhagwan, who is by nature absolutely blissful. Understand? So sun cannot have any darkness. So Bhagwan also cannot feel any unhappiness, because Bhagwan is by nature. He is Satchidananda, full of bliss. Like one devotee told Shripad Dandi Maharaj that, you know, Maharaj, I have fractured my leg. Shall I take painkillers on Ekadashi day? And Maharaj told that devotee that no need to take painkillers on Ekadashi day. If you have excruciating pain, then only cure is the Harinam. You chant Harinam. Harinam is the greatest medicine. Dhanvantari is the biggest doctor. There is incarnation of Bhagwan called Dhanvantari. So he is having four arms and is carrying the pot of nectar of immortality in his hand. So that Dhanvantari ji, who appeared from the churning of the milk ocean, Maharaj said, you remember Dhanvantari or Krishna, and chant Hare Krishna and give up that I am this body. Give up that identification that I am this body. All the pain comes from identifying with the body. Understand? When we have no bodily identification, then the pain will not be there. So what to do when you have very excruciating pain? Like many cancer patients, they have such excruciating pain that they have to be given morphine. But how much morphine you can inject? So how many injections can you take? Sometimes their entire skin becomes like a sieve full of so many holes. Because how many injections you can give in that delicate skin? So then Shripad Dandi Maharaj, what he said, that give up the identification with the body. I am this body. That is the easiest way to get rid of the pain. Once you give up this identification, then immediately pain will go away. So, and then you remember Bhagwan, because Bhagwan is blissful. It is not possible that you can be unhappy by remembering Bhagwan. Understand? So Shruti also states, Aditya Varanam Tamasa Parasta. Like the supremely luminous sun is far above darkness. And that is why Bhagwan cannot be touched by any of the happiness, any of the unhappiness felt by the jivas. being the inherent form of ananda, he remains continuously overwhelmed by ananda. So Bhagwan cannot be touched by any of the unhappiness felt by the jivas. And that is exactly we have to remember actually. With all the war that is going on, so many innocent souls losing their life, and all this is for, this is not the first war in the history. There were already so many wars. So many wars were fought among the kings. The earth is sometimes laughing and ridiculing these kings who are fighting for the control over the piece of land. She says that millions and millions of kings and soldiers have lost my life to obtain possession of me. But no one could have possession of me. One day they have to die. So, but if you are trapped in that condition, like for example, once the Japan was bombing Kolkata. The Japanese fighter planes came and they were bombing Kolkata. Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj was householder that time. His name was Abhay Charanaravinda Prabhu. And he didn't know what to do. He simply started chanting Mahamantra, doing loud kirtan. Bombs were falling everywhere. And they told Abhay Charanaravinda Prabhu, Abhay Charan Prabhu, day, please leave your residence. There are so many bunkers government has created underground. Go there, take shelter. Otherwise, bomb may fall your head. And Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj said, yes, I want to die chanting the Hare Krishna mantra. If I die chanting Hare Krishna mantra, I'll go straight to Golok Vrindavan. I don't want to take shelter, go to the safer place. Let me die chanting Hare Krishna mantra right in my home. Once they rented him one cottage, one house, and he wanted to rent a house for his family in Prayag. And they told him that, owner told him that, I will give this house for very cheap, very less rent, because this is haunted by ghosts. Then Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj said, wonderful. If I am getting for cheap, I will take it. And I am not afraid of ghosts. And he started doing loud kirtan every day with his family, children and wife. And slowly, slowly, all the ghosts left the place. Because that place was purified. Understand? So, any type of attack, whether the soldiers, army, enemies, ghosts, demons, when you chant the name of Krishna, because Krishna is always blissful, absolutely blissful, then there cannot be any darkness there, there cannot be any worry there, there cannot be any tension there. So being the inherent form of ananda, he remains continuously overwhelmed by ananda. People in general, however, are touched by the misery of others and mercy awakens within their hearts. Understand? So here, Shri Bhagwan is the condensed form of supreme bliss, Paramananda. Although all potency to make the impossible possible, along with all other potencies, always resides within him, still it is not possible for him to express compassion directly for the wayward jivas. So here it is told that there are wayward jivas. The jivas who have defied the orders of Bhagwan. We were shown the spiritual world and we were shown the material world at the beginning. We were not attracted to the spiritual world. We are attracted by the sight of material world. And being mesmerized by the so-called beauty of the material world, we landed in this material world. When we came here, maybe we were a dog, cat, hog, pig, monkey, Indra, Brahma, God knows what was our first body. And since then, we have been taking millions and millions and millions of bodies, just transmigrating. So we are the wayward jivas. We have forsaken Bhagwan. And that is why the mercy bestowed autonomously by great souls is in fact the sole means to effect the deliverance of the abject and unhappy jivas. So you see that, compare your life before you read the books of Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, or before you met the devotees and especially Gurudev. How are your condition and how happy you are now? Although you may not have so much material possessions, you may be older, weaker, deceased, but there is a sense of happiness on your face. Like one time in the airplane, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, many disciples were sitting, and a Christian monk was there also on the same flight. And he told Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, I don't understand what you are really doing. Because we believe that only way of emancipation is to surrender to Jesus Christ. But you are engaging in some chanting of Hare Krishna mantra. I really don't understand what you really do. But I can say one thing, that the faces of your disciples are very bright. They are very bright and they look very happy. Then Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj said, this is because they chant Hare Krishna mantra and they follow my orders. He is the representative of Bhagwan. So we are, Bhagwan cannot directly give compassion to the wayward jivas. For example, an example is given that if you have committed something wrong as a child, then your father wants to punish you. So what you do, you hide behind your mother. So father looks at the mother and forgives the child. Otherwise, there will be a severe thrashing waiting for the child. This happened to me many times in childhood. If I did some prank, then my father wanted to beat me. And I used to hide behind my mother or elder sister, who my father loved very much, and somehow get pardon from father. Because looking at the mother or my sister, understand? So what you have to do is, in order to be forgiven by God, you have to take shelter of the spiritual master. So, the great souls are autonomous. What is autonomous? They are authorized to deliver the unhappy jivas. Understand? There are some abject and unhappy jivas, and no one can match the mercy of Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. One time Srila Gurudev was telling that, he asked Gurudev one question. Oh Gurudev, why you don't call him Prabhupada? And Gurudev said, I don't call him Prabhupada, but I have more love for him than anyone of you. He asked one question, that there are so many disciples of Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, like Tamal Krishna Maharaj, Giriraj Maharaj. If anyone of them will take the title Prabhupada, can they do so? Then they told Gurudev, no one in ISKCON, no guru in ISKCON can take the title Prabhupada. That is the GBC resolution. Only person who can be known as Prabhupada is Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. He can be called Prabhupada. If anyone will take the title Prabhupada, they will be immediately punished by GBC or ISKCON. So Gurudev said that we also, all the disciples of Gaudiya Math also, my Gurudev and Bhakti Rakshak Chidra Maharaj, they all had a meeting and they decided that although any disciple can call his Guru Prabhupada, but still we will never take this title Prabhupada. It is a birthright of every devotee to call his Guru Prabhupada. But still, for respect of Bhakti Siddhanta Sarasvati Prabhupada, we will not take this title Prabhupada. So that's why, to avoid the confusion, we only call Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati as Prabhupada, but Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, we address him respectfully as Swamiji or Swami Maharaj. But I have more love for him than anyone else in the world. Srila Gurudev met him when he was only 26 years old, Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. And since he was 26 years old, he started serving Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. And kept on serving till 1977. When he was leaving the world, he told him that I have collected so many unqualified disciples. They are like monkeys. Please guide them. And Gurudev promised him that, yes, I will help the disciples of ISKCON. So here you see that one great personality, he can bestow mercy upon you. Or he can entrust another great personality to bestow mercy upon his disciples. So if your guru leaves the world before you are mature, fully mature, what is your duty? Then your guru has left the world before you fully mature. Your duty is to approach another elevated sadhu and receive teachings from him. And that is what exactly many disciples of Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj did. And those who did it, like Bhaktivedanta Padmanabha Maharaj, was Rukram Prabhu, Bhaktivedanta Nevi Maharaj, Bhaktivedanta Vaikhanas Maharaj, Shyamaran Didi, they all survived the Maya, because Maya is very strong in the Western world. And many of them who did not surrender and did not follow the guidance of elevated Vaishnavas, they ended up falling in Maya. They gave up chanting, Kanti Mala, got married again and again and again and again and again. Understand? So this shows that Ashram Laiya Bhoje, Tare Krishna Nahi Toje, Ara Sabha Mare Akaran. You should always be under the guidance. We are never so strong that we can conquer Maya. Daivi Hesha Gunamai, Mama Maya Duratte, Mame Vaya Prapadyante, Maya Metam Tarandi. Like Guru Granth Maharaj used to say, that his Maya is very strong to overcome. Especially, no one can overcome the Maya in the form of opposite sex. But Srila Gurudev told us, always regard the woman as your mother, like sister, daughter. Don't look upon women as objects of your sense gratification. And women should also look upon all the males as their brothers, sons, father. No, never and never regard any living entity as the object of your enjoyment. Then only you can conquer this Maya. See everything as Gurudev was making a point that Jiva is Bhokta and Bhogya. Jiva is the enjoyer and Jiva is also the enjoyed. The living entity is to be enjoyed by Krishna. But living entity is also the enjoyer, because he can enjoy the happiness of serving Krishna, called Sevananda. Understand? So here I said that when their hearts are thus melted with compassion, they show mercy to the wayward souls. Because of this, Sri Bhagavan, who is all compassionate, places his own mercy in the heart of these great souls and keeps their mercy completely independent, so that the common people can become inclined to him. And this is how actually I see. I was in United States. In 1996, I was living in ISKCON, New York. And there were many book distributors. I used to go regularly to temple, although I was not living in the temple. Then I used to see that slowly, slowly, the male and female devotees, they started leaving the temple. Then I inquired why this has happened. Says one of the gurus got married. He fell down. So his disciples left the temple. They lost the faith in the movement. Then this and then that and then that. Slowly, slowly I saw that almost the temple was empty. Four or five devotees were somehow managing the deity seva. Then congregation members, mainly Indian, used to come and used to cook on Sunday. And then used to go after taking prasadam, they used to go. No preaching was happening so much. Why this came? Because there has to be a spiritual master who has complete strength, who is empowered by Krishna, who is a pure devotee, who is a Rasik Vaishnava to guide them. The second problem that came with many organizations, that they could not ascertain the goal of life. And that's why the members become disillusioned with them. What is the goal of life? Many began to tell that Varnashram Dharma is establishing of Varnashram Dharma is the goal of life. Many said that book distribution is goal of life. And this point Srila Gurudev made. One time Prem Prayojan Prabhu was a very famous preacher traveling with Gurudev. He told something about book distribution. And Gurudev said that I recommend that everyone should distribute books of Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. and my books also. You should distribute them. But what is the mood behind distributing those books? If the mood is to make profit and keep 75% profit with yourself and give only 25% to temple, then it is not Shuddha Bhakti, it is Aropa Siddha Bhakti. It is only you are superimposing bhakti upon some mundane desires. It will become Swarup Siddha Bhakti. The book distribution activity will become a Swarup Siddha Bhakti if it is done to please Guru and Vaishnavas. If it is done to please and to bring the conditioned jivas out of Maya without the profit mentality. So Gurudev always told, give my books less than the printed cost, at the printed cost, or even little bit more than printed cost if you are a householder for little bit maintaining your family. He said, I want all householders to maintain their family by charging some little commission on the books, 10% or something, just so that you can have a very simple living, frugal living, but don't live opulently by selling books. But he said, it is million times better to distribute my books as a business rather than doing some other business. But always make sure that your intention is clear. You want to help the other living entities and not make profit. It should not be run like a pure business motives. But if someone thinks that reading this book will change that person's life, that person needs this nectar, first you should read the books. If you have not read the books yourself, then what is the point in distributing the books? Because so many book distributors also fell down and got married. Because they never understood what was written in the books. They all were believing that, oh, Sri Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj came to this world only to give Nama Sankirtan. And Gurudev said that, no, he had not come just to give Nama Sankirtan. If you were to give only Nama Sankirtan, that would be like Advaita Acharya, who could give Nama Sankirtan. Advaita Acharya was giving Yuga Dharma Nama Sankirtan. He had come to give the Unnatojala Rasa, the great mood of Manjaris, Rup Manjari and others. Don't think that this Harinam is mundane thing. Nama Chintamani Krishna Chaitanya Rasa Vigraha Purna Shuddho Nitya Mukta Vinnatva Nama Namin. Shri Gurudev was talking about Lokanath Das Goswami. A great prince came to meet Lokanath Das Goswami. That prince told him, I want to take initiation from you. Lokanath Das Goswami refused. That prince used to clean his stool in the night time. The area where he was passing stool in night time. Lokanath Das Goswami caught that prince once. His name was Narottam Das Thakur. Why are you cleaning my stool? Oh, I want initiation from you. Lokanath Das Goswami initiated him. Gave him an adjacent bhajan kutir, small hut next to his own hut. And told him there is chant Hare Krishna mantra. This is non-different from Krishna. And one time very hot sun, a farmer came there. And that farmer was thirsty. He told Lokanath Das Goswami, give me water or give me a rope and bucket. I will draw the water from the well. I am very thirsty. Lokanath Das Goswami was so absorbed in chanting Hare Krishna mantra, he didn't reply. So he went to the next bhajan kutir of Narottam Das Thakur, and Narottam Das Thakur gave him a bucket and a rope to draw the water to quench his thirst. Then Lokanath Das Goswami told Narottam Das Thakur, please don't stay in this bhajan kutir next to me. You can go wherever you like. You can go to Bengal, your native place. Because you don't know that there is no difference between holy name and Krishna. Why you gave up chanting Hare Krishna mantra to quench the thirst of this farmer? Actually, was he angry with Narottam Das Thakur? No. But he thought that Narottam Das Thakur, completely innocent and a great devotee, but he should preach. And on the pretext of showing anger to him or giving him chastisement, he sent him to Bengal. Because Lokanath Das Goswami was doing bhajan. He was bhajanandi. And he wanted Narottam Das Thakur to be Goshthanandi and preach fallen conditioned souls. So very difficult to understand the dealings of pure devotees like Loknath Das Goswami, Narottam Das Thakur. But there is a hidden message. You should never ignore the holy name. Don't think it to be equal to any other mundane activity. Like many people, they are walking and chanting. Gurudev said, will they get perfection very easily? In any yoga, the first and foremost thing is to sit down properly in Padmasana or any asana. If your asana is not fixed, Shuddhanam will not come. But it may so happen that you have so much leg pain. If you sit in one place like 12 hours, 14 hours, actually Anirudh Prabhuji, then you may have some deformity in the foot. Which happened to Anirudh Prabhuji, that he cannot stand on both the legs because he, for many years, 20 or 30 years, he chanted 3 lakh, 4 lakh, even 5 lakh holy name continually, 20, 22 hours every day without getting up, getting out of his room. And that's why he lost ability to stand on both legs. One leg became little weak, he was telling me. So if you are feeling pain, then you can walk a little bit, no harm. If you are very tired, even lie down and chant. Whether you are pure or impure, there is no such restriction for chanting the holy name. Understand? But best is to sit and with properly and chant the holy name. So here Gurudev is telling that like Bhagwan, sadhus also wander in the realm of Ananda, which is made up of Shuddha Sattva, pure existence. And therefore, they cannot be touched by any of the unhappiness of the material world. There's a very famous bhajan of Tukaram Maharaj in Marathi. You can hear it on YouTube. Maybe Lata Mangeshkar has sung it and other great singers have sung it. I like that bhajan very much, where Tukaram Maharaj is talking about Ananda. He says, I am diving in the lake of bliss. There is only bliss and bliss and bliss in all my four directions. That lake of bliss has only the water of bliss. And I'm relishing that bliss. What lake is talking about is the bliss of devotional service of Krishna. Ananda chedohi ananda taranga. Ananda chianga. Ananda chianga. Anandate anandache dohi anandataranga. So he's telling about a bliss. So such a man walking, waking from sleep can remember the miseries he felt in the dreaming state. And the Mahapurushas sometimes remember the miseries of this world. Understand? So like that, we have a dream. In a dream we see that, oh, tiger has devoured me. Sometimes even I have nightmares. I see that my exam is there tomorrow and I am not prepared. Because I underwent very hard engineering course. And there was so much homework given to us. So many subjects, so many formulas to remember. Used to get nightmares. Even now we get nightmares. Understand? Thinking of that engineering course. Because there are deep impressions on the consciousness. So like a nightmare, but Srila Gurudev told that once we go to the spiritual world and we are embraced by Krishna, like Gopakumar, Sarup, they all went to spiritual world, Bhurat Bhagavatamrutam. Then this material existence will appear like a dream. Understand? That as if it was a nightmare, that's all. Not more than that. And that's why Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita that once you have come to me, my dear Arjuna, don't be afraid. Aham tvam sarva papyebhyo mokshayishyami ma shucha. Devotee doesn't want to be freed from all the sins. But Bhagavan promises him, don't worry. I will forgive all your sins. But that should not be our motivation to chant Hare Krishna Mantra. But rather we should tell Bhagavan like Tukaram Maharaj that, oh Bhagavan, if you want to put us in the womb of the mother again and again and again and again, and give us birth in the material world, no harm. I am willing to accept another birth, material birth, but I don't want to forget you. Always give me good association, don't give me bad association. If you really want to give me birth on the earth, then give me association of a pure devotee. Like Shivas Pandit, he was always chanting Hare Krishna Mantra. Or Hari Haraya Nama Krishna Yadavaya Nama, Yadavaya Madhavaya Keshavaya Nama. And one time, Mahaprabhu told him, hey Shrivas, how will you maintain yourself? How will you take food, fulfill your needs like clothes and other things for your family? You're not doing any work. You are not even begging. You should beg. You're Brahmin, you are authorized to beg. Or you should go to work and earn some money. Your children and family, you are all five brothers, not doing anything. All day Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, this is not good. Then Shiva said, I have solved the problem of food and clothing very easily. In my three snaps of fingers, I solved his problems. He said like this. Mahaprabhu said, why are you snapping your fingers thrice? This is the first day I will chant Hare Krishna all day, all night. The second day also I will chant all day, all night. Third day also I will chant all day, all night. And if 3 days I don't get any food to eat, then I will take a big boulder, big stone, tied around my neck and jump in the Ganga. And I'll commit suicide. And Mahaprabhu said, my dear Shivas, I guarantee, I promise you, your entire family, your five brothers, their children, wives, I'll ensure that they never lack food and clothing. Even Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune, may have to beg from door to door, but those who are chanting Hare Krishna mantra will never have to starve. And even today, Srila Gurudev was telling that I have never worked in my life, I don't have any business, but Srila Gurudev was telling that I have never starved. Never start. It is the experience of all the devotees, not only Gurudev. Even once Srila Gaurgovind Maharaj, he resigned from his job as a teacher. The people, when he was resigning the job as a teacher, they told him, don't be sadhu, you'll starve. Then one time his birthday was there, his Vyasa Puja. That time they had made 108 preparations for Thakurji. And he was showing those preparations of Mahaprasad to the devotees. And he said, yes, when I was renouncing my work, job, they told me I'll starve. You see, I'm starving. There are 108 plates of Mahaprasad. I don't know. Even if I take one morsel of each plate, I cannot eat. There are so many preparations devotees have made with love and affection for Thakurji. And so much Mahaprasad is available. So we should never and never think that, oh, Bhagavan will not take care of. So one time, a great kirtan was going on in the courtyard of Shivas Pandit, and Shivas' son died. Oh, when the son of Shivas Pandit died, Shivas Pandit told the female members of the family, don't cry. If any cry will escape from your mouth, I will punish you. Mahaprabhu's kirtan should not be disturbed. Mahaprabhu is engaged in blissful dancing and kirtan. But somehow or other, Mahaprabhu sensed some gloom in the air. And he asked, I'm not feeling some happiness today. Has any untold incidents or some sad incidents has taken place? And they told, yes, today Shiva's son has died. Mahaprabhu said, immediately bring his body here. They brought the body before Mahaprabhu. And Mahaprabhu uttered Hare Ram ki Hare Krishna in his ear, and that boy came back to life. Shivas, and then that boy told Mahaprabhu, why you brought me back? I had gone to a better place than this place. Why did you bring me back? Then Mahaprabhu said that your mother and father, you know, you are the son of your mother and father. But he said, no. Actually, I am only servant of Krishna. And I had gone to a better place. I want to go back to that place. Don't disturb me and my progress in spiritual life. Then Shiva said, let him go. And then Mahaprabhu let the son of Shiva go again back to the place where he was. So someone asked a question to Srila Gurudev. Oh, Gurudev, what can be a better place than the courtyard of Shiva's Pandit, house of Shiva's Pandit, to have a father like Narad Muni, Shiva's Pandit? And what could be a better place than Mahaprabhu's Sankirtan? Then Gurudev said, maybe by the blessing of Mahaprabhu's Kirtan and Shiva's Pandit and Mahaprabhu, he went to Gopi's association. He went in the company of Rukmanjari, Ratimanjari and Radhakund. And maybe he didn't want to leave that place. Because if you engage in the devotional service of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you will get Krishna Bhakti. The gift of Krishna Bhakti will come automatically if you serve Mahaprabhu. That's why he's gone to that place. So he didn't want to stay in this place. He's gone to a better place, he thought. So, here it is told that because of this, Sri Bhagwan, who is all compassionate, places his own mercy in the heart of these great souls and keeps their mercy completely independent, so that the common people can become inclined to him. Therefore, Bhagwan's mercy is transmitted into the heart of the jivas in the wake of Mahat Krupa, the mercy of great souls, and not through his own personal will. Now one may counter this notion by saying that Antaryami Bhagwan, who governs from within as super soul, inspires the hearts of all living entities and grants the power of activity to their internal and external senses. In answer to this, Bhagwan himself says in Bhagavad Gita, Ishvarasara Bhutanam Ruddeshi Arjuna Tishtati Brahmayansara Bhutani Yantra Rudhani Maya. So Bhagwan is called Antaryami, who governs from within as super soul. Understand? Antaryami. Super soul is in everyone's heart. Like there was a great devotee by the name Kanak Das Ji, and he was told by his guru Vyasatirtha that please eat a banana where no one is seeing you. But Kanak Das came back with the banana. He said, there is no place in the world where super soul is not watching me. I cannot eat this banana. Means he could see that super soul is watching all our activities. Upadeshta Anumantacha. So therefore, Bhagwan is governing us from within. And he is inspiring the hearts of the living entities. He grants the power of activity to their internal and external senses. We cannot even raise our hand if Paramatma doesn't want us to. We cannot even blink our eyelids. When we are sleeping, who is breathing on our behalf? Who is making the strokes of our heart going on? Heartbeat going on? Who is pumping the blood through our arteries? It is Paramatma. We are eternally indebted to Paramatma. He is carrying on the functioning of our body even when we are asleep. Understand? So in answer to this, Bhagwan himself says in Bhagavad Gita, Ishvara Sarabhutanam Ruddeshi Arjuna Tishtha. O Arjuna, the indwelling super soul is situated in the heart of all living beings. By his illusory potency, he causes them to wander in the cycle of birth and death, engaging them in various material activities as if they are mounted on a machine. So people are completely controlled by Paramatma and Bhairanga Maya. Maya and Paramatma are controlling us. Understand? We are not controllers. We are the controlled. So in this way, so does the all-powerful autonomous Supreme Lord have any control over his devotees' activities? In this regard, it is said that the internal and external senses of the devotees, which are a result of their previously unseen destiny, as well as the ability of those senses to receive Bhagwan's mercy potency, are actually under Bhagwan's control. In other words, it is Bhagwan's own potency alone that duly governs the revelation of his mercy potency in the senses of the bhaktas. The devotees are not fully independent in this regard. Understand? So we are not independent. We are controlled. So this is this will, this discussion will go on. So the whole point we'll summarize now to recapitulate that Bhagwan wants to bestow mercy on all the living entities, and therefore he has made the pure devotees his agents, and these agents have full authority to bestow mercy on anyone and everyone. Like they have an order, shoot at sight. As soon as you see someone, shoot that person. When there is actually in India, sometimes any social lack of peace is there, is sensed by the government, they order, shoot at sight. They say 144 is applied. There is one law called 144. So they use the 144 on constitution, the 144th this thing, and they say we'll shoot at sight if anyone is trying to disturb the peace of the society. So like that, a pure devotee also like that, shoot at sight. They can see anyone, they glance at that person, and that person is transformed. If they want, they can bestow mercy on anyone. The moment that person approaches a pure devotee and folds his hands and says, I am very fallen, I am very wretched, please make me fortunate, they can bestow upon him the wealth of love of Godhead. They can bestow upon him Shraddha and Bhakti of Krishna. So pure devotees are so merciful, they are more merciful than Krishna. Understand? Like Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj was telling that, see, Mahaprabhu delivered some fallen souls, but by the mercy of Mahaprabhu, we had delivered so many more fallen souls. Because Mahaprabhu has empowered Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, like Gurudev, Srila Guru Gobind Maharaj, that delivered so many fallen souls. Understand? So, you should read the books. Srila Gurudev used to say that we should read the books, Chaitanya Charitamrita, Chaitanya Bhagavat. But Japada Bhagavata Vaishnavira Sthane, Ekanta Ashrayakara Chaitanya Charan. You have to go to a high class Mahabhagavat, study books under their guidance. Understand? Srila Gurudev was telling when he was preaching that don't think that Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj has written everything in the books, so I don't have to go to any spiritual master. He said, no. He has written everything in his books, but he has locked all the conclusions in the lock and key. All the conclusions are locked in lock and key, and he has kept the key with me, a pure devotee. And when he left the world, he kept the key with me. And if you want, I have brought many jewels from India. And if you want, I will give those jewels to you for a very small price. Because you don't have much money, you are poor persons, he used to tell the Western devotees, I will give these jewels for a very small price. But if you don't want to buy even for the small price I am charging, then I will take these jewels of bhakti to India, where they will get very big rate, very high rate in Vrindavan and Mathura. There are so many devotees who want to purchase these jewels. So take these jewels for a small price. What is the price? Just offering pranam. Just following the orders of Guru. Just doing Ekadashi. Like Gurudev is telling about Ekadashi, that one cow was not dying. And one disciple of Gurudev came to Gurudev. Gurudev, cow is not dying. Gurudev said, give her the benefit of one Ekadashi. And then that cow peacefully left the world. Gurudev said, Ekadashi is so powerful. Gurudev was telling that, knowingly or unknowingly you do Ekadashi. We know that so many times fights take place between husband and wife. And if in such fight, if husband is angry with his wife and wife is angry with the husband, and if both of them don't eat due to fight, and if both of them cannot sleep due to remembering the fight they had, and both stay awake all night on Ekadashi day, still they will get the benefit of doing Ekadashi, Gurudev was telling. So this is called Agyat Sukruti, knowingly or unknowingly. Understand? They'll get the benefit. So we should try to follow the orders of Gurudev. We should respect all the Vaishnavas. One very big confusion Gurudev told us has come is that We should only respect those who are the disciples of Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. Anyone else, we don't have to respect. This is actually a very big misunderstanding that is there. As Srila Gurudev was asking that, is Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj written anywhere in his book that you don't respect anyone except my disciples? Has he written like that? But rather, Gurudev was telling that anyone in Shamananda Parivar, Narottam Parivar, Channava Parivar, Advait Parivar, any pure lineage, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's tree of devotional service and disciple succession, he may be initiated in any line of Mahaprabhu. We should respect him and consider him to be our God brother. We should not disrespect that person. We should think him to be our brother. That's why many times they say that Jiva fell from Vaikuntha. This is not the correct Siddhanta. And many people will become discouraged by this. And this leads to Mayavad philosophy. Has the Jiva fallen from Vaikuntha? Then what difference remains in the Vaikuntha and the material world? If Jiva is also false in material world, and he also falls down in Vaikuntha, both places are the same. What's the difference between them? This is totally Mayavad. But Krishna himself says in Bhagavad Gita, Yadgatvana Nivartante Tad Dhamma Paramam Mama. Once you go to the spiritual world, you never come down. So how can Jiva fall down? Understand? So first and foremost is that we should learn this Siddhanta correctly. That Jiva never falls down. Understand? You should approach a spiritual master who can explain to you all these tattvas. But if the spiritual master tells you, give me all your money, then I will solve your problem, then first of all, you reject that spiritual master. Why does he need your money? Means he himself has so many problems. How can he solve your problems? He is only after your money. But a pure spiritual master will tell, I don't need your money, and I don't need your bank balance and gold. But I want only your ears. Give your ears to me and listen very carefully what I am telling you. Don't be so attached to wealth and don't be dependent on wealth. This wealth cannot save you at the time of death. Only bhakti can save you. Only Harinam can save you. If someone is telling you like this, he's a true spiritual master. Like Gurudev was like that. He told us, don't be engaged in attached to money. Don't try to get married again and again and again. This will not help you in your bhakti. By Krishna's desire, whether your marriage has worked or not, you should not get married again. But rather think that Krishna is my husband and serve him. He will not cheat you. Don't try to enjoy this material world. Know this material world is meant for only Krishna's enjoyment and it's a miserable place. No one is happy here. Death will certainly come. Don't try to take revenge on anyone. Like one Brahman lady was there. Her only son went to pluck flowers from the forest and a snake came and bit that boy. So snake charmer caught that snake in a wooden box and brought before that lady. I'm going to cut this snake to pieces and burn his body. He told, your son he has bitten and your only son has died today. The lady said, by killing this snake, will my son come back? The snake charmer said, no, your son will not come back even if I kill this snake. Then why do you want to kill the snake? Leave him alone. But he was not listening to that Brahmin widow who has lost her son. The snake charmer was intent on carrying out his desire. He wanted to cut that snake to pieces, chop him to pieces. Then the snake spoke, hey, I was told by Yamaraj to beat this boy. I am not guilty. Then he said, Yamaraj is guilty. Then Yamaraj told Kala Purusha, the time factor told me to arrange for the death of this boy. Then he said, Kala Purusha is guilty. Then Kala Purusha said that, no, it is the karma of this boy. The boy had killed the snake in his past life, so he has to undergo that fate. The snake has to set the account right, and that's why I beat him. It was from the past life this was going on. It was his karma he has to suffer. So if something like this happens to us, if someone curses us, abuses us, cheats us, takes all our life savings, all our golden eggs in the retirement basket, retirement nest, all our golden eggs are stolen, and we are left nowhere, penniless, and still Gurudev said, don't retaliate. Don't retaliate. Because know that it is your own past karma that is coming to you. If someone slaps you, you should think that it's my own hand which is slapping me. I should not blame that person who has slapped me. Maybe I have slapped him in past life, so that person is coming and slapping me. Those who think like this and remain more humble than a blade of grass, more tolerant than a tree, they are qualified to do bhajan. Otherwise, you are not qualified. Be very obedient to your spiritual master. Like Gurudev had one disciple, Param Gurudev, Srila Anangmohan Brahmachari. He had tuberculosis, TB. He was vomiting blood, passing stool, diarrhea. Sometimes Gurudev had to clean his vomit, stool, urine, everything. All the godbrothers of Param Gurudev became very upset with him because he was spending so much money on his disciples' medical expenses. They all left Param Gurudev. They said, no, you are showing too much affection to your disciple. But Param Gurudev said that this boy has taken my shelter. How can I reject him? Till end, I must look after him. So Gurudev told Param Gurudev that don't worry about Anang Mohan Brahmachari. I'll take care of him. You focus on your duties and acharya. The small things like cleaning his stool and urine and his vomit and giving him medication and bathing him and changing his dress, I will do it. Going to hospital and medication, everything I'll take care. So Param Gurudev started loving Gurudev like anything because he was so dedicated to his godbrother Anang Mohan Brahmachari. And when Anang Mohan Brahmachari was about to leave the world, he shouted, oh Baba, you have come. He used to call his Gurudev Baba, father. Oh Radha Krishna, you have come. Yes, I am ready. Please take me to Golok Vrindavan. Tears welled in the eyes of Gurudev. Gurudev prayed to Anang Mohan Brahmachari, you are going to a very far off place, Golok Vrindavan. When you go there, you remember this poor governor and your godbrother. And Gurudev said, I realized that very day how great is attachment to spiritual master. How important is to be attached to the spiritual master. This Anang Mohan Brahmachari had not done much japa, has not done much devotional service, but he had so much love and affection for Param Gurudev. He used to sleep with him. He used to be always with him, like a shadow. Like his own father, he used to treat him like a father. And because of that love and affection he had for Param Gurudev, Param Gurudev also reciprocated with him. And not only that, because our Gurudev showed love and affection to Anang Mohan Brahmachari, our Gurudev also became very dear to Param Gurudev. So when we serve our God brothers and God sisters, then our Guru will also be very happy with us. If we serve only our Guru, but don't serve our God brothers, God sisters and other devotees, then Gurudev will not be so happy. But when we not only serve our Guru, but all the Vaishnavas, we try to help all the Vaishnavas to our ability and very respectful to them, very kind to them, very compassionate to them, even their small children, we should help them. Then Gurudev becomes very happy. He becomes very pleased. Understand? So this is very, very important. Don't be attached. One day we'll have to give up this body. This body will not come with us. Hare Krishna. So happy Papa Mochan Ekadashi to all of you. Today actually very important to bathe in the ocean, because ocean is the husband of all the rivers, Samudra Narayan. So, but anyways, if you cannot bathe in the ocean, then at least by mind you should go out to a nearby ocean like Jagannath Puri or anywhere, Venice Beach or anywhere, and you should take bath mentally in the ocean today. Understand? Hare Krishna. Vancha Krishna.
Hare Krishna. In this part of the world, Guyana, we don't have river to bathe in. The water is so dirty, we cannot bathe. Is it you're talking about the salt water is necessary? Or?
No, mentally you can bathe in the ocean, mentally.
Okay.
You can bathe mentally if you cannot physically bathe, because I know that many oceans are really polluted. And bathing in the ocean also, very dangerous also. Especially Ekadashi day till full moon day, a new moon day, there'll be high tide.
Yeah.
So if you cannot bathe in the ocean physically, then mentally you should bathe.
Okay.
Anything that is done mentally also has great, great effect. Like so you want
explain the mental part. Because the mentally, mental part is, it's not easy to bathe. Thought power is not so clean. Is it has to do with food? Is it has to do with what is it to go mentally clean?
Actually, mind is a very powerful organ.
Yeah.
For example, someone is having very good eyes, good ears, good nose, good mouth, good tongue, good skin. Yeah. But if his mind is weak, then that person is not of much use. So that's why we have 11 senses. The 5 working senses, hands, legs, mouth, anus, genitals. Also 5 knowledge acquiring senses like eyes, ears, nose, tongue, skin. But also 11th sense is the mind. Mind, manah eva manushyanam karanam bandha moksha. The mind is the cause of bondage and mind is the cause of liberation. So you have to engage your mind in service of Krishna. And especially mind is so much controlled by food you eat.
Yes.
Like if you eat the food cooked by non-devotees, then your mind will not be controlled. So try to cook yourself and offer it to Krishna. But many people, they were neophytes when they joined ISKCON. So Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj told him that you ring a bell and you chant Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate or Namo Brahmana Devaya Go Brahmana Hitaya Jagaditaya Krishnaya Govindaya Namo Namo. And you should offer like this. This was the basic thing which was told. But Srila Gurudev told that no. Suppose your Gurudev will tell you, bring me very nice hot milk, 1 cup of milk. And instead of bringing a cup of milk, you pour cold water on his head. Will he be happy? You have to chant the proper mantra for that deity. For Gauranga Mahaprabhu, you have to chant this Swaha. For Radha Krishna, you have to chant the proper mantra with their names, Swaha. You have to learn these mantras, how to make an offering. But many times, the people misuse the... there is one injunction that, okay, Dravya Mulena Shuddhet. You can, anything that you have purchased is pure. But that is for new fights. For advanced devotees, they should cook with love and affection and offer with tulsi leaf and with proper mantra. Understand? Then that offered food you should take. Like one time Draupadi...
Yes, stop.
Draupadi. One time Draupadi was laughing at Bhishma Pitama. Bhishma Pitama was explaining great knowledge on the battlefield. His body, he was lying on the bed of arrows and he was explaining moral precepts. And Draupadi said, where had you forgotten the moral precepts when I was being stripped naked? Then Bhishma Pitama said that all the food of Duryodhan, which had gone to my blood, my mind was contaminated by that food. because the food given by Duryodhan was full of so many sins and so many bad thoughts that it had curtailed my ability to counter the injustice done to you. But since the arrows of your husband Arjuna has drained most of that contaminated blood, not all, but some, most of the blood is drained, some sense of justice, righteousness is dawning upon me. So Vishay Anna Khala Malina Mayahan Malina Hayaman Malina Mana Haile Nahi Krishna Smaran. If you take the food cooked by non-devotees, your mind will be contaminated. And with that contaminated mind, you cannot remember Krishna. So first and foremost thing is that eat only the foodstuffs cooked by devotees. Learn how to cook. And cook in the mode of goodness, not meat, fish, eggs, onion, garlic. Understand?
Yeah. Another thing you mentioned, slave to a guru, being a slave to a guru, the importance of being a slave to a guru.
Accepting guru.
Yeah.
So we have to accept the guru.
Principles. Now and then you must give the prayer. What you use when you eat, when you cook. I would like to get some of those prayers.
Sure. I'll make a write-up. Especially when you're cooking, don't use the shoes. Many people, they use the shoes. If it is not very cold, we should always not use shoes or socks. We should bare feet.
Cooking.
Because when you are cooking, the good energy from the Mother Earth should go on the food.
That energy is restricted
if you are wearing shoes or socks. Understood?
It's black.
So in the kitchen, never use any shoes. Always chant the Mahamantram when you are cooking. Because when you are chanting the Mahamantram, anyone who is taking the food cooked with love and affection and chanting the holy name, that person will also develop the propensity to chant Hare Krishna mantra. Understood? And mantra for offering that I will send you, no problem.
Yeah.
You should, but don't cook anything like onion, garlic, and carrots. Some people, we Chaturmasya, we don't take even eggplant, brinjal. But in Gaudiya Math, 8 months we are allowed to eat brinjal. But some people don't even take eggplants. But Gaudiya Math, there is no such rules and regulations.
Meta Mataji from Trinidad. Actually, I leave Guyana and I'm in Trinidad right now with a Mataji. She is Budan Maharaj. Her guru is Budan Maharaj. So, Meta.
Haribol.
Hare Krishna.
Nice to meet you. Hare Krishna. Haribol. So you are a disciple of Srila Bodhan Maharaj.
Yes.
I met him in New York in year 2003 in 21st Avenue. And we did Sankirtan with him in 42nd Street. Then also in Mayapur Parikrama, we always meet him. And he knows me. And Shripad Dandi Maharaj is also a very good friend with him, because whenever he comes to India, when he comes to Karnataka, sometimes he used to call Shripad Dandi Maharaj, please come with me, travel in Karnataka with me. So like that.
In Caracas, which guru is in Caracas? Paramadvaita Maharaj?
No, Paramadvaita Maharaj, he lives mainly in Vrindavan when he comes to India. But in Karnataka, yes, Shripad Dandi Maharaj is there.
Okay, okay. Because Prema Dwaiti Maharaj and Gurudev come to Trinidad. They were here. Oh my God, these people make noise. 2018, I want to say 18, 19. Some time ago, yeah, both were here.
Oh, very good.
But Gurudev comes to New York to my house, to my home. And in Trinidad, oh, yeah, here to my home.
Very good, very good, very good, very good.
Yeah.
Jai Jai. No, very good. He's a very good devotee. Our Gurudev used to say, Shripad Bodhayan Maharaj is a very good devotee. He's a very sincere devotee. Our Gurudev used to say that he was appointed successor by Srila Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami Maharaj.
Right. Srila
Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami Maharaj was served by my Gurudev. Actually, my Gurudev joined the math and Gaur Purnima. He got initiated, then he was sent to render service to Srila Bhakti Pramod Puri Maharaj. Srila Bhakti Pragyan Kesava Goswami Maharaj told my Gurudev that he should give service to Srila Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami Maharaj. So he used to always serve Srila Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami Maharaj. Also, whenever he used to write any books, he used to go and present them to Srila Bhakti Pramod Puri Maharaj with love and affection. And Srila Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami Maharaj also used to bless my Gurudev, used to say that, yes, you are preaching very nicely the mission of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada. You are writing so many books. I am very pleased with you. So, we are actually in one sampradaya. That's why our Gurudev's mission always was like this. That all the Gaudiya Mats in ISKCON, they all should unite. And we should know that actually there is no, we are not different families, but we are all one family of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. We should have common Vaishnava calendar, and like we should have common Kirtan, we should have Harikatha, and we should respect each other's gurus. And all of us are in the Mahaprabhu's family, because Upadeshamrut, it is very clearly told. Krishnetyasya girintam manasa adriyata ikshasti cheta pranate bhishya bhajantam isha shushrushaya bhajana vidyam ananya manya nindadi shunyam hrudyavipsita sangalabhya. One is chanting Hare Krishna, respect him in mind. One is initiated, do pranam to that person. If someone is free from any type of enviousness and 24 hours a day serving Krishna, pure devotee, you should render profuse service to such a non-envious devotee. Understand? So unless we follow Upadeshamrut, how can we advance? Understand? Nowhere in Upadeshamrut, Rupa Goswami has said that we respect only these particular sadhus of this institution. We don't respect sadhus of that institution. Not like that. So Gurudev said that Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj also, he didn't write any new books. He only translated the books of previous acharyas and commentaries on them. He wrote Srimad Bhagavatam, but actually it was his commentary. The book was written by Vedavyas, Sukhdeva Goswami, Suta Goswami. And also Chaitanya Charitamrita, he wrote commentary, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. But he did not write the book. It was written by Krishna Kaviraj Goswami. He wrote commentary on it. So he has not given anything new. He has only narrated to us the pastimes of previous acharyas. Whatever they are written, he has commented on that. But some people think and say that, oh, we should not read any book, any other book, only we should read Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj books. But Gurudev said that, no, suppose someone is reading Chaitanya Charitamrut and he becomes curious to see a verse in Chaitanya Charitamrut, from that verse is quoted from Shri Bhaktirasamrita Sindhu. And then he becomes curious, let me read the Bengali Bhaktirasamrita Sindhu. And let me get clarification. I want to learn more about this topic. But it is not wrong. So sometimes someone may want to read Jaiva Dharma of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Then we should not say to him, oh, no, you should never read the books of previous acharyas. You should only read what your immediate guru has given, or Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj has given. This is not what, even Swami Maharaj will also not be happy like this. Why any acharya would stop anyone from reading the books of previous acharya. So my Gurudev also used to tell us, you should always read Jaiva Dharma. You should know Dashamul Tattva very well. You should know all these things. You should read Bhakti Samrata Sindhu Bindu. You should read Ujjwal Nila Manikaran, Bhagavata Amrit Kana. Always read my books and distribute them. But don't distribute without reading. Try to understand yourself first. We are trying to save the world, but we are not saving ourselves. You should first try to read them yourselves. Be always dressed like a devotee. Gurudev used to say that don't dress in non-devotee costumes. I don't want that type of preaching. Oh, any sannyasi like a wig and wearing trousers. No. Sannyasi means you should always be in sannyas dress. Brahmachari should be always in dhoti kurta. Mataji should be in saris and tilak. Don't try to hide your identity. Gurudev never wanted that type of preaching. You should always, like for example, Putana. Why Krishna gave mercy to Putana? What does Putana mean? Putana. Puta means pure. Na means who's not pure. Understood? So that is Putana. Understood? But you see that Krishna blessed her also. She was such a wretched demoness. She tried to kill Krishna. But what Krishna gave her? Gave her position like Mother Yashoda in spiritual world. Aho bakiyam stanakala kutam. Jigam saya payat apiya sadvi. Leve gatyam dharti uchitam tatonya kamva dayalu shanam. Who can be more merciful than Krishna? Even his enemies is giving the topmost destination. Understand? Krishna is so kind to his devotees. One time, Krishna has many cows, they went into the forest, and cowherd boys also went behind the cows. And all of a sudden, the forest of the Munja grass caught on fire. And when fire takes place, Gurudev said that the wind also will blow automatically. Why? Because fire will create the vacuum in the bottom. The air will be ignite and it will go rise up. So to fill the gap underneath, again the wind will come from outside. So because of the fire, automatically wind starts blowing. And then due to the wind, the forest fire was spreading like anything. All the cows and Krishna's cowherd boys, they became scared and they began to shout, Krishna, oh Balram, please save us. Krishna came there. And he told the cowherd boys, don't worry, close your eyes. And they closed their eyes and Krishna drank the fire. Why he told them to close the eyes? Because last time he ate the clay, dirt, then they complained to Mother Yashoda. So if now he drinks the fire, they'll complain more. Second thing, that many cowherd boys would have died seeing Krishna drinking fire. They could have never tolerated that our best friend is drinking fire. So Krishna told them to close their eyes. When they closed their eyes, they found that all the fire was gone and they were sitting underneath the Bhandirvat and they were honoring their breakfast, and with the cows also were nicely eating the grass and sitting there peacefully in the shade of the... So like that, these cows represent our senses. And we are looking for sense gratification, wander in the forest, and then all of a sudden that forest catches fire. Understand? That time what we should do, we should call out, Ha Krishna, Ha Balram, Hey Krishna, save me, save me. Then Krishna will save us. But try to be always, avoid the wrong decisions. Like many people, in front of Radha Krishna, they are loudly doing Narsingha Kirtan. Loud Kirtan, Narsingha Kirtan they are doing. That is fine to remove the obstacles in your bhakti. But at the time of aarti also, what is the point in when you are doing Radha Krishna aarti, singing Samsara Dava Nala Lida Loka Tranaya Karunya Ghana Ghanatva? No. Before you are doing the aarti to Radha Krishna or Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you should finish that Guru Vandana, Samsara Dava Nala Lida Loka or Pranamami Sada Prabhupada Padam. Pray to Guru and Prabhupada before you begin the aarti of Radha Krishna. When Radha Krishna begin, you should do only aarti to Radha Krishna. Jai Jai Radha Krishna, Yukala Milan Vahad. Jai Jai Vora Chandra, Kusha Vahad, Mangalashi Guru Vahad. Understand? If you are doing aarti to Radha Krishna and you are singing loudly, Namaste Narsingha, what will happen? or Radha Krishna will immediately fly from that place and leave that place. Understand? So we should learn to sing proper songs at the proper times. Everything has a proper time. But we cannot disregard Narasimha Dev. But after Radha Krishna's aarti is done, all everything is done, then you can finally pray to Narasimha Dev that there I am so many demons in my heart. What are the demons? More dangerous than Hiranyakashipu and Ravan. Our lust, greed, anger, madness, envy. Oh, Narasimha Dev, please devour these demons, kill these demons, and free my heart from these demons. We can pray like this. Understand? But don't sing the wrong song when doing devotion service. Always try to sing the proper songs. You should have proper mood always. Understand? And you should always sing the appropriate songs. Worship Radha Krishna. We don't want to worship Rukmini, Raman, Krishna. No. Jambavati Raman or Satyabhama Raman. No. That is not our aim and object. Our aim and object is Radha Raman Krishna. Understand? So try to learn this from Upadeshamrut. Tannam Rupa Charitadi Sukirtananu Smrityo Kramedarsana Manasi Niyojya Tishthan Vraje Nuragi Jananu Gami Kalam Nait Akhilam Iti Upadesha Saram. We should chant and remember Krishna's sweet name, form, quality and pastimes. And Tishthan Vraje by mind or by body stay in Vrajadham under the guidance of sadhus. And unless you follow this Upadeshamrut or Manas Shiksha, how can we advance in bhakti? So we have to see that where we stand. Every 15 days or 1 month, we have to do audit. That in last 1 month, my japa increased or decreased. My chanting increased or decreased. My meditation increased or decreased. Did I make progress or regress? I went back. I went ahead or I went backwards. You have to see. You have to evaluate. Ekadashi to Ekadashi, we should do this. Ekadashi is the day of contemplation. See what progress you are making. And if you are not making any progress, if you are filling so much water in a pot, but that pot is always empty, then you should know that that pot has some holes at the bottom. And all the water you are filling in that pot is drained through these holes. So if you are not advancing in bhakti, then Gurudev is telling that you have to find the loopholes. Where are the loopholes in my bhakti? Why my bhakti is not increasing? And try to plug those loopholes. And if you cannot do that, then you have to approach an advanced devotee. That, sir, you are like my spiritual master, you are my shiksha guru or diksha guru, please help me. You are sadhu, please help me. I have this problem. You have to tell your problem submissively. That sadhu will tell you some solution. Understand? So be always under the guidance. Don't be independent. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Thank you, Maharaj. Thank you so much.
Anyone has any question? Or everyone is okay?
No. You will send the prayer for me.
Yes, yes. I'll send them on Telegram, okay?
Yes.
Thank you.
So I'm on a holiday, actually.
Oh, good, good.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Wonderful. Happy holidays to you. But chant, keep on chanting. Okay.
Yeah, I went and visit a temple in ISKCON temple in Trinidad here.
Very good.
Beautiful, and I reach, you know who? Agni Prabhu, Maharaj. Agni, he is a disciple of Srila Prabhupada. He met with Srila Prabhupada in America. And for the first time, he said he heard Krishna, he feel it, and he surrendered and become. So he is here.
Very good, very good. Actually, many, what happened at ISKCON, Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, many were attracted to him. Many were attracted to him. But because of lack of guidance, many of them they went back, they could not make much progress.
Yeah.
So the Gurudev always used to tell us that don't think that you have to boycott Chaitanya Charitamrita, 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. You should only read Bhagavad Gita all life. Gurudev gives an example. There is a well. My father has a well. My grandfather's well is there. My father used to drink the water from the same well. But now that well water is dirty, rotten. So many insects have fallen that well. What should be my duty? Shall I use the same well or should I dug up another well or find a river? I should go to another well or a river. Like Ganges River is flowing nearby with very sweet water. I should go and fetch some water from that Ganges River and drink that water. But I should not take the water from the paternal well, my forefather's well, if it is rotten and having insects. So an institution which cannot fulfill the desires and give you pure bhakti, you should abandon it. Understand? You should join an institution which is vibrant with sadhus. The institution is not walls, it is not bricks, it is not rubber stamp, it is not trustees, it is the sadhu. Srila Gurudev told one thing, that I am in Gaudiya Vinand Samiti, but I am general secretary there. But the moment I feel that Gaudiya Vinand Samiti is not useful for my bhajan, in a moment I will leave it. I will leave that society. We should only be in the society where our bhajan can advance. Otherwise, simply for the sake of passing our time there, we are not here to control others. Don't try to control others. First, try to control your uncontrolled mind. We are not the controllers. Let Gurudev be controller. Let the Vaishnavas be controllers. First, try to control your uncontrolled mind. This uncontrolled mind has brought you so low, all of us.
Yeah.
We are in this material world. So Gurudev always used to tell us, hey, don't try to control others. Don't try to find faults in others. Try to find faults in your own self. Don't show faults of others. There are other persons to correct others. Your guru will correct them. Krishna will correct them. And if they cannot correct them, Yamaraj will correct them.
Yeah.
Hear attentively Harikatha. If you hear Harikatha attentively, Gurudev used to say, then airplane will come from Vaikuntha to take you. And if you don't hear Harikatha attentively, then Yamaraj will come in a buffalo cart sitting there to punish you. Like Dhundukari was attentively hearing Gopinath Bhagavat Katha, so airplane came and took him to Vaikuntha, although he was a ghost. And those who did not hear the Harikatha of Gokarna attentively, no airplane came for them. So Harikatha you should hear attentively, Gurudev used to say. Gurudev used to say, when I am speaking Harikatha, don't make garlands. Don't do this and that thing. Don't even chant when I am speaking Harikatha, Gurudev used to say. Hear only what I am saying. I have come from so far to give you this Harikatha. Don't waste my time. Gurudev used to say, I have given up my bhajan. I was doing bhajan in Vrindavan. 2 lakh Harinam every day. I gave up Vrindavan. I gave up Navadvip just for you. And if you don't hear attentively, what is the use? Like Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj used to say, he was happily doing bhajan in Vrindavan. He had a room in Radha Damodar. He sacrificed his bhajan in Vrindavan. He used to say, Vrindavan is my home. Mayapur is my place of bhajan. And Bombay is my office. Why he gave up Vrindavan and Mayapur? Was he short of any food? Was he not getting enough chapatis in Vrindavan? Was he starving?
No.
No. He took compassion on us.
Yes.
So we should not waste our Gurudev's time.
And then he goes to America and get weak because of serving people who are souls, yes, who are empty.
Right.
So
she wants to show compassion.
Now that we are in this clean food, sometimes your mind gets weak. What do you, you can use vitamin to build it in order to get blood? Is it possible, you know, we eat pure vegetarian food, right? But you know, you have to deal with so many things, so many people, and you get weak. Is it necessary you can use vitamin?
Actually, most of the vitamins available in the market, they are all having animal products in them. So Shripa Dandi Maharaj, he tells us not to eat any market vitamins. And if you want to take any vitamins, you can make yourself any green leaf juice like this, yourself, like spinach juice, and you can take them. That has enough vitamins for you. Or eat, if you cannot take raw vegetables, you can eat, semi-cook them or cook them and eat the vegetables, greens. Only one in Chaturmasi, the first month of the rainy season, you don't eat the greens. Rest of the year, allowed to eat greens. On Ekadashi day also, you don't eat greens.
Ekadashi and which other day?
Ekadashi day and also in the month of rainy season, like Chaturmasi. The first month of Chaturmasi, you are not supposed to take greens. Yeah. That time many insects are in the greens. Yeah.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Sorry, Maharaj. I will take lead now. My battery is dying and the power will go off. Sorry, Maharaj. Anup will take over. Ananda Mohan. Thank you, Maharaj. Thank you. Dhanavats.
Hare Krishna. Dhanavats. Hare
Krishna. Chaturdasi and Ekadasi. No grains.
No grains.
And the natural spinach. Another thing is, a lot of these vegetable and fruits has toxic. Which one has less? These vegetables and fruits, some of them have a lot of toxic inside that affect the mind and get it weak. Which one of them is best to take?
Actually, we don't take onion, garlic, carrots. These are not allowed. Other vegetables are okay. Most of the vegetables are chemicals now, unless you are doing organic farming. But it's okay. You have to soak them in water, with salt water, and many toxins will come out. Make an offering to Krishna.
Nuts is good?
Yeah, we should soak the vegetables in salt water, you know, for some time. So their pesticides will come out, unless you can grow your own vegetables.
What about nuts? Nuts are good?
Nuts are good. Nuts are good and they're fine. Whatever you eat, you offer it to Krishna. Understand? But not as a means of sense gratification, because nuts are sometimes too much fat in them. We should eat. We should not live to eat. We should eat to live. We just want to keep our body and soul together. Not so much focus on nutritious food. We are not here to become wrestlers, bodybuilders, but we are here to do bhajan. Like our Goswamis, they used to eat very simple foodstuffs. Like in Parikrama also, many times, when Gurudev used to call the devotees, Western devotees for Parikrama, he could not offer them anything except khichadi. Morning and evening, only twice khichadi. Sometimes he used to give some sweet, but sometimes not even that. And they had no separate rooms, the Western devotees. When they were doing Parikrama in the beginning, no rooms also with attached toilet bathroom. And sometimes Gurudev used to say that they had to go to international toilet, means in the open air, to pass stool. And also taking bath in the rivers or in under any public open place. But they said no Western devotee used to complain, because they used to love this simplicity of life. Understand?
Yeah.
So, forsaking all the comforts of their Western countries, they used to come to the Dham to get mercy of the Dham. And Gurudev used to say that if you want to mercy of the Dham, then you should be very, very humble. Understand?
Yeah.
Like Sis Goswamis, they never used to eat any opulent foodstuffs. They barely used to sleep. 1 hour, 2 hours they used to sleep. Mm-hmm. We cannot avoid sleep. We cannot sleep less than 6 hours, 8 hours, 9 hours. But they barely used to sleep. Understand? So we are not Goswamis. We can eat and we can sleep what we need to sleep and eat. But at least chant Hare Krishna mantra. Can do something. At least 4 rounds, 8 rounds, 16 rounds. Better that you do 16 or more. If you do 64, very good. Like Anil Prabhu just said. but at least do something. Don't say that. Gurudev used to say that, don't tell I am disciple of Om Vishnu Bhava Rashtota Shishan Bhaktidhan Narayan Goswami Maharaj, and then not do anything. Then people will say, what type of disciple is this? What type of disciple Gurudev has initiated? So when we are giving his name, then we should also not make sure that his name is not spoilt by our actions. We should be seen chanting. Because if you chant even once the name of Krishna, then you can jasu nama japa ekahi bara utarai narabhava sindhu apara. If you chant the name of Krishna even once, very quickly you will cross this ocean of repeated birth and death. Not many people understand the glories of the holy name. It is more chintamani, desire, wishful pulling stone. We should try to not take Harinam lightly. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, thank you everyone for joining today's class. This concludes today's meeting. Hare Krishna.